So welcome back to some more Earthbound, where last time we said goodbye to a lot of the people who made our journey the journey it was, and to the teammates that made it all happen. And this time, we're going to be doing all the last minute things that I never got to talk about and some trivial things that we can show. And I feel like an idiot because I tried to record this and I realized I never clicked record on anything, so I'm doing this again. Really quickly, I grabbed the bike from Tracy. Don't know if you're wondering why the hell would you ever go and grab the bike again. Trust me, it's for something I want to go and show real quick. So, PSI teleports. We're going to Deep Darkness. So, the interesting thing here also, I used that withdrawal service on the quote-unquote recording that I was doing, so that's why I have a lot more money than I should. So, that withdrawal guy is down there with a snorkel. So, you know how you move slowly in the swamp here? Also, there's no status effects anymore, so you will not get poisoned. If you bring out the bike, it completely negates the slowdown from swampy areas. And I guess anywhere that would make you slow down. Granted, Deep Darkness is the only place that would let you pull out a bike, but yeah, strange, needless to say. I guess the bike is useful for something. There's that. Sure. I don't know. Anyway, I just wanted to show that off. We are now gonna head back to Onette. So, this is the episode where I'm going to be talking about a lot of things that didn't have a good place to talk about and a lot of trivial stuff that, well, we can now talk about. Some of these things will be left out until after the credits and all that when we're back on the title screen, simply because there's just no other good place to put them, and it'd be kind of, well, not really spoilery of the credits scene, but it's a better place if I do it there. So, get used to this music again, because I'm going to be standing out here talking about trivial stuff. First of all, I'm talking more about Ness and Smash in this case. For people who know of Ness and Smash, and well, most people only know of Ness from Smash, you would notice that he has two moves in Smash that he cannot perform in Earthbound at all. That being PSI Fire and PSI Thunder. They kind of explain this in the Smash lore. In Smash Melee, Paula's trophy explains that Paula actually taught Ness PK Fire and Thunder to prepare for his debut in Smash, which is kind of cool. I think that's a cute little tidbit, especially since, you know, canonically Ness and Paula are, you know, dating and all that, so I think it's cute that it's Paula that helped out Ness for that. And now we're getting into stuff that is external information for the most part. So, there's one guy that we never got to talk to. It was Fuzzy Pickles Guy. Fuzzy Pickles Guy is gone from the world. At least if you went to every single one of his spots. And there's actually something that's cool with the Fuzzy Pickles Guy. In an official player's guide written by eToy himself, the Fuzzy Pickles Guy was hired by an adult Ness in the future, specifically 10 years in the future, to take pictures of Ness's journey that had not been documented in that timeline. That's why the Fuzzy Pickles guy just comes out of nowhere, takes a picture, and then teleports out. He's from the future. Which, dear God, adult Ness, that sounds weird, but yeah. So that's a funny thing. That's a really funny thing. And here's all the trivial missing stuff that I want to go and talk about now. First of all, there are many mysteries of the games of this game that are still being debated upon and, at the time of this recording, have actually been solved for the most part. First of all, the photo at the very beginning of the game that showed a street corner and all that. There's a lot of photos in this game that are taken from real-life places, and a lot of people have made it an effort to go and try to find where those places are. And for a long, long time, people theorized that that live-action photo, well, was a live-action photo. After digging around, more recently, it was found that it is not a real photo of anywhere. It was computer generated. After all these years, man, and people thought it was a real place trying to find where it was. And I guess talking more about weirdo stuff, there are various spellings of Earthbound that are inconsistent with canonicity. In many cases, it's either Earthbound with one capital at the front for the E and everything else is lowercase, Earthbound, which is capital E at the front and capital B for bound, or in all caps, Earthbound. The same kind of thing goes for Mother 2 in Japan. Mother 2 is either capitalized at the front in lowercase everywhere else, and then the number 2, or it's in all caps. Another thing I want to talk about is debug modes. For some reason, there are 3 debug menus. One for while the game is running, one while the game is booted up, and one while it is in the middle of a battle. Fun fact about the one that is, the second one I mentioned, for the, before the game is booted up. The cursor for that is Kirby, for the debug menu for that. It's a reference to Kirby's Dream Course, which was being developed at the same time as Earthbound. Kinda cool. Now for some anti-piracy measures. I know, we're going all over the place today, but yeah, I figure it's a good time to go and talk about all these things right at the end. If this game has weird anti-piracy measures that are actually kind of funny. For one, enemy spawns go ridiculously insane if the game detects a pirated copy. It makes it to where the game is just unenjoyable with the amount of enemies on screen. And you're probably saying, oh, like with the slowdowns you've been getting. No. In some cases, there's like 10 to 15 enemies on screen. So, yeah. A major tell of if the game is a pirated copy is at the very beginning of the game. In Onet, a pirated copy will spawn spiteful crows, which are not supposed to spawn there. It's kind of weird. And this is Onet proper, not the house at the very beginning. I'm talking about in town. Lastly, and this is evil, the last anti-piracy check this game has is during the Gygas fight. After the Pokeface, the game will crash, force you to reset, and your save data will be gone. So you could technically play the game all the way up until Gygas and not even get to fight him because anti-piracy measures. That is cruel and... what the balls? Oh, my controller turned off. Okay, that was weird. So yeah, that is cruel and unusual punishment, but I mean, hey, just don't pirate the game, I guess. Now for beta content, which isn't really much. Ness's backpack almost didn't exist in beta content. For some reason, old designs show him without a backpack. Paula also had a slight change, for she carried a lunch bag looking thing instead of a little purse. Yeah, really not much for beta content. I mean, there's other ones I mentioned during the LP, such as how Paula's jail was turned from a cabin. So, yeah. There's some weird stuff. You'll have to go through the LP to go and find out those other bits and pieces that I mentioned before. I'm not going to repeat them here. Now, concept art. There's a lot of concept art for this game, and they're really cool. For example, Dr. Andonuts' design was drastically different. For his hairstyle was a nuclear warhead. His lab also looked really different, and it was inside of a meadow as well. Saturn Valley was an actual valley in concept art, and the art depicts some UFOs just flying around, which is kind of cool. Stonehenge originally was only one pillar, and there's a design of Jeff that resembled Lloyd from Earthbound Beginning / Mother 1. It was probably just an early concept piece for Jeff, and they just used Lloyd because he's a similar character. An image named Winter's Village was in the concept art designs, which could have been a potential town for Winters. We don't really have a town for Winters at all. And that's strange because it's one of the few areas where you can teleport to, but there's no town there. As for Tessie, she was originally named Tassie, and the event of where she was would have been in a grassy area. So, that's pretty much all concept stuff. Some things I did leave out is the designs for Dungeon Man and Delam. Dungeon Man looked really cool. His head was like a giant ancient city thing. And it was just really cool. It was probably very impractical to really include, but yeah, it was cool. As for Dalam, Dalam is very based off of Middle Eastern / Indian design. It originally was going to have Russian architecture, but it was changed to be what it is now, and I think it's kind of for the better. I think Dalam looks a lot better now. Along with that, Dalam was supposed to be on the end of a waterspout from an elephant, I'm pretty sure. Again, I guess it was just practicality issues with, like, how would you get up there from the, like, how would they put in the elephant? So, it's interesting stuff. As for control stuff, again, we're going all over the place. Earthbound was designed to be played with one hand. And for most of this LP, I have been playing with just one hand. And not for the reasons you're thinking. Because, the L button acts as a designated check button, so you can eat pizza while gaming. That was one of the slogans for this game, is that you could eat a pizza while playing the game and not have to have greasy fingers on your controller. I love how weirdly quirky this game is. I love it. Now let's talk in-game stuff. In-game stuff. When you start a new game, there is a rare case where if the game cannot read the save data, it states, and I'll put the quote on screen, "We're very sorry, but the record of adventure number one has been lost." This dialogue is also weirdly printed, as it was likely unintended to ever discover. Also in Japan, it starts with the words, "What the?" which, again, adds to the quirkiness of this game. Other stuff is, at the very beginning, if you don't equip the cracked bat in front of Pokey, Pokey goes on a fourth wall breaking rant about equipping items. And other weird stuff is, there are unused sprites where King, or Czar, or whatever you named the dog, could have, had sprites for climbing, implying that he could have been more permanent. Unfortunately, there's no real way of making him a permanent party member because the game would just crash, but yeah, it's just weird. Another thing too, and this might help you for people who want the game to be a little easier, HP scrolling is slower when on slow text speed to compensate for spamming through menus. So, if you want a little easier time trying to survive an attack, put the game on slow text speed. And I want to talk more about the doctor too. I mentioned that the doctor is completely pointless and we really never used his services. He only heals damage-dealing ailments. So he's basically healing Beta in a trench coat. Why would you ever need that when PSI exists? So. And another thing too, if you end up getting a call from Dad on a bike, it glitches out your ringing to be like a weird horn more than a bike ring. This is hard to pull off because it's every 2 hours that Dad will call you, and I'm pretty sure he does not call you at the very end of the game, so just keep that in mind. And there is a newspaper headline that is very hard to find, but it's interesting to mention in terms of Everdread. We never got to see Everdread again. A newspaper in Foreside reads that, "On page 23 of the Foreside post, lonely demise in the city, long-haired man with beard, sunglasses, and aloha shirt found in street." That pretty much confirms that, you know, Everdread is gone. And continuing with Everdread's death, there's an unused sprite of a ghostly version of Everdread similar to when a party member is downed. It was likely that this was going to be used at some point, but they never implemented it into the final game. And I talked about this too in Deep Dark, the Lost Underworld, where if you use Teleport Alpha and crash into an enemy as enemies spawn, or no, this isn't Deep Dark, never mind. There's a weird glitched out enemy that if you fight it can crash the game. So yeah, be careful if you're teleporting into Deep Dark or Lost Underworld, because bad things can happen. As for the Flying Men, I never got to show all of the gravestones. We saw the first two. There is a total of 5. And I'll show the other 3 right here. Their gravestones become sadder as they go on, slowly missing whose gravestone it is, to the point where you don't even know whose gravestone it is. And I want to talk more about Starstorm Omega. Starstorm Omega is completely useless. Here's the problem with it. First of all, you get it so late in the game that you don't really get to use it all that often. We only used it once, and that was against Gygas. Unless if you're grinding the Gutsy Bat, most enemies, including Gygas, have shields that reflect it, just making it a bad move to use. And since it's so late in the game, there's just so little opportunity to actually use it where it makes sense. So, honestly, Starstorm Omega, while cool, is just kind of there for no reason. So, and in my notes I have all the Gygas talk from last episode, but yeah, no. Also, as for, that's talking about credits, I'll talk about that. Jeez. As for more cut stuff, this is more talking about Smash Melee in particular, but it's still related to Earthbound. There is various cut music from Earthbound and its associated spin-offs in Super Smash Bros. Melee. In Melee, there was a cut song from the Onette stage that was shown before the game was ever released, but it never made it into the final game, which is kind of sad. Now for random bits that just did not fit anywhere else. On the gas station title sequence, the person credited for that gas station scene is named M.D. Seeger. According to Starman.net, this is actually Shigeru Miyamoto, which is kind of funny. He probably didn't want to actually be credited with it, so that's why M.D. Seeger, but whatever. And at the very beginning, you notice that when you change options around, you'll hear the word Okidesu ka. That is Itoi's voice, which the sound designers inserted into the game without his knowledge, and Itoi thought it was great, so he just left it in the game. At the very beginning, too, I mentioned a long time ago that if you hack the game and go through walls, you can actually find Captain Strong out by the meteorite during the beginning of the game. They don't say anything, but it's still a cool little trivial bit that Captain Strong is there. And lastly, at least things that I think are big things I wanted to talk about, Moonside was not of Itoi's doing. Moonside, according to Starman.net, Moonside was created on free reign by Itoi's assistants, which explains its super creative design and weirdness. Itoi had nothing to do with Moonside besides just letting it stay in the game. And honestly, I'm glad it stayed in the game. So, I guess now that that's done, there's only one last thing to do. Well, two last things. Dad was part of our adventure too. We should probably talk to him. Hey, it's your dad. To get to the next level. I guess you don't need. I don't need to tell you this anymore. Next week will be your birthday, Ness. I'm trying very hard to be home for that big day. I'll be sure to get you a good present. I've been following your adventures closely, but I want to hear about them from you, in person. You sound a lot more mature over the phone. Well, I'll see you at home yet, then. I don't even get to save. I just want to make sure, too. Yeah, okay, I still have Paul on that. There's something I want to show with that. So, yes, the last thing we can do is talk to Mom. Actually, we can talk to the dog. But I know you guys saved the world. I think Ruffini knows, too. Wow, you've become such a strong young man. I'd like to hear all of your stories, but I don't want to annoy you as soon as you walk through the door. After all, your chats with people you met on your adventure are finally over. Please come back here. The photo man brought an album by. I'd like to look at it with you. Did you finish doing everything you wanted to do? Yeah. I said goodbye to everybody I wanted to say goodbye to. Okay. Now you can finally share your incredible experiences with me. You did so well. Welcome to the ending of the game. Man. It feels weird to be here. We got the Runaway 5 thing going here. Man, this game was a trip. It really was a trip. Also, for the credits scene here, I think it's a later song that comes up. The song named Smiles and Tears has lyrics in Japan. There's your other piece of trivia. And I guess I can give my final thoughts and my thanks to everything. This game was a massive passion project. This game deserves a lot of attention. And this was the first game where I really started making tons of notes for it, because there's just so much information about this game. And so much of it that it's just really cool to discover. And I love this little credit sequence, it's really cool. So, before I say my thoughts and all that, I want to give special thanks in my, I guess, my source location for all the information that I got of this game. And first of all, a ton of this information was derived from Chugga Conroy's LP of Earthbound, his more recent one. Despite current things that happened, I still have to give credit where credit is due. So that is where a ton of information came from. So I'm not going to credit myself for finding that information, for he laid it out on throughout his LP for that. And I do recommend watching that LP at least. It is a good LP. Mr. Saturn. Other outside sources that were used to support the information from those videos of his were earthbound.fandom.com, wikibound.info, the general Wikipedia, and the official Earthbound Player's Guide, along with starman.net. Those sources helped out a lot trying to comprise and get all the information that I wanted for this LP. So, again, sources are listed for that. That is where a ton of the information I got for this game came from. And I guess this is time for my last few thoughts and thank yous. I sincerely love this game. This is the second time I've ever beaten it, actually. And I have a lot more appreciation now that I learned so much of the game and also did it as an LP. This is definitely... Oh, the flying men. Oh, God. Oh, they're alive again. So, yeah. There was a lot of good moments through this LP, and there's a lot of people who have enjoyed it as well. Thank you guys in the comments. You guys have enjoyed this LP a ton, as I have, and there's a lot of... Is that God in the middle? What the hell is that going on? There's been a lot of funny moments, and I'm glad that there's a lot of people who have enjoyed it as much as I have. And I love how Dad is just... referenced as a phone. That's kind of sad. So, I thank you guys for making this LP very special. For it was very special. So, he's here! He's here! The Photo Man! Now you can finally see his purpose. One last Fuzzy Pickles. Ready for the camera? Ready, save Fuzzy Pickles. What an amazing memory. There we go. The real credits. This is the song I was talking about called Smiles and Tears. In the Japanese version, this had lyrics. So, again, thank you guys so much for enjoying this LP and just having as much fun as I have with this. I never did grow up with this game. I mentioned this at the very beginning. I never grew up with it. I never played it until I was an adult, and before that, I just only knew of it because of Ness being in Smash. And I guess, by extension, Lucas from Mother 3. And while this isn't, like, my game or anything like that, this is not the special, special game, it's still a very special game to me, and I highly recommend that everybody plays it for themselves, because while you can watch somebody play it on the internet, it's such a different experience when you play it for yourself. There's so many things in this game that are only going to be stories that you could tell from your perspective. And it is a shame that this game is not as accessible as it should be. The only legitimate way, I should say, is through the Nintendo Switch Online membership, at least at the time of this recording. So, at least it's sort of available, but it's... I wish there was some kind of remaster or remake or whatever. Now, a remake or a remaster would not do this game justice because of all the weird copyright crap that they had to deal with for this game, but still, it's an important game and I think it needs more attention than it should. So, besides that, from a personal experience of the LP, this was a big undertaking. I have never made notes this long before. If you want to know how long my notes were for this, I use a Word document for them. It was 177 pages long with 28,000 words within it. And there probably is still a lot more stuff that I could have added. That is just all the interesting stuff that I had discovered when doing research. And again, a lot of that was through watching through Chuck Conroy's LP of Earthbound, and that helped cut things down a lot, but there was also personal research that I did when searching stuff up, again, through Starman.net, through Earthbound wikis, from the general Wikipedia, and from Wikibound, and the official player's guide. So, it's just, there was a lot of research put into this game, there was a lot of effort from my end, and I'm glad I did it. And I think from here on forward, at least with LPs that I think deserve it, I think I will be doing more and more notes as time goes by, because it really does help out make these LPs better than they should be, I guess you could say. And plus, there was a lot of personal moments with this LP, and a lot of funny things that happened. We went through a lot for this game, and it's just crazy that we're at the end of it. Now, before I say anything else, technically this is not the finale. This is the finale for the game particularly, but this is not the end for the LP. There is one last thing I want to go and do, and it's mostly just for something fun. We're going to be taking on the tent once again. I promised a long time ago that I would go back to the tent in Threed and have some fun with it. So, that will be next episode. Next episode will be just screwing around with the broken tent. So, I hope you guys look forward to that. And I'll just leave you guys at the credits. There's nothing left for me to say except thank you, and I hope you guys love this LP as much as I do, because this game was a ride, and I have a lot more appreciation for this game. I have a lot more appreciation for this game than I thought I did now. As with that,
I miss you.
I will see you guys in the next one. Take care. What happened? What? Really? Really? You saved this for now? Why? well, yeah, there is an after credits thing. Damn it, Dad! No! I don't need a break! Wow, that is a really good... Wow, you had to have one last one, Dad. Really? Alright. So welcome to the beginning of Earthbound once again. Someone's knocking at the door. What an annoying knock. I'm curious. No. What do you say? My land, who could be knocking at this time of night? Would you answer it? Picky. letter arrived from my brother Pokey. It's addressed to Ness. There's no stamp, and it's no and it's no time for the mailman to come. Anyway, I brought it over. It says, "Come and get me, loser." Spankity, spankity, spankity. I wonder where he is. The end. Question mark? Earthbound 2 confirmed, please. I wish.